So my name is Philip Benz, and I'm here with Chaoning Zhang, who is also in the test and will also speak today. And what we will be talking about is adversarial transferability and beyond. And as mentioned, this is our second time here, and we're actually really looking forward to present to you some of our recent research and what we might be also working on in the future. So a little bit of words to us. I already introduced our names. We are both PhD students from the Robotics and Computer Vision Lab at KAIST here in South Korea. And we are both focusing on adversarial machine learning as our research field. And we are also always looking for research collaborators. And we indeed actually really mean that. So if anybody out there is interested in joining or has some good ideas related to this research topic, or maybe something also not that far related, please always feel free to shoot us an email, and we will see how we can come together. Okay, then some of our we selected some of the recent works that we selected that we published in the last recent 2 years. So we published at major conferences in the field, such as the AAAI, NeurIPS, or CDPR, ACCV, etc. And
this is a crazy list for 2 years. A lot of job you guys are doing, a lot of work.
Yeah, we try to work hard. Yeah, thank you. So let's get started. Introduction. So as you probably as a when you often listen to this 2D, 3D AI talks or presentations, you will see that deep learning is awesome and has achieved great success in multiple fields like object detection, robotics, autonomous driving, game playing, those voice assistants, etc. And what our focus is actually mainly focuses on is always as the classification, because it's one of the basic building blocks. All those backbone architectures are usually classification networks. And however, this great success always also has a negative side, and these negative side are adversarial examples. So all those deep classifiers are vulnerable to adversarial examples. And these adversarial examples or perturbations are small perturbations in the image, which were specially crafted to deteriorate the performance and be mostly imperceptible for a human observer. So for example here, if we initially have a panda image and we add this small crafted noise, then we will actually end up, our classifier will say, this is a gibbon. So this is, and as you can see from this image, for a human, this is nearly not perceivable that this image was altered. So this is one of the big issues with deep learning or deep neural networks, and actually was also often termed as one of the fundamental issues with our current deep learning. So, and if you look at those deep classifiers that I showed before, and how we can see that their performance degrades drastically only by such a very simple attack like the FGSM attack, which stands for the fast gradient sign method, which we will also introduce later again, which we actually also introduced in our last talk. So speaking of the last talk, I just want to do a very brief recap of our last talk. So I also put the link here. So if anybody of you is interested in rewatching that or just checking it out, I give a very brief overview, not longer than 1 or 2 minutes. So what we actually handled last time were mainly universal adversarial perturbations. And we actually tried to provide an alternative perspective on universal adversarial perturbations, because previously UAPs were considered as noise. And we now actually stated that they are more features. This actually led us to design of a data-free targeted UAP attack. And we also tried to understand the influences of we tried to understand this UAP thing from a frequency perspective. And we found that these DNNs are highly susceptible to high frequency or to high frequency content. And we also showed in the beyond part how we can actually also use small perturbations for deep hiding Yeah. So, one second. Okay. Yeah. Just to recap, the main takeaway was basically universal perturbations contain dominant features and images behave like noise to them. We did a Pearson correlation analysis, and which led us to this new finding. We designed this targeted data-free targeted UAPs, which actually showed very well performance. And here data-free related to that we actually using a proxy data set instead of the original trained data set. So if it was previously, if the classifier was previously trained on ImageNet, we actually used a proxy data set, for example, the COCO data set or anything else, also random images from the internet would suffice. And we established this frequency perspective and also a few other universal attack methods. And the main takeaway there was DNN is highly sensitive to high frequency patterns. And then we also introduced this universal deep hiding framework where we can actually encode like a secret image, encode a secret image into a cover image, then transfer it and reveal this again. And we showed therefore its applications for steganography, light field messaging, and watermarking. So there were also a few other things that we introduced, but this was on a high level what we discussed last time. And today we will talk more about another property. So last time it was more about the universal property of adversarial examples. And today we will talk more about the transferable property of adversarial examples. So, and we will first cover like adversarial attacks. So just to set the stage, adversarial attacks, what is the definition and the goal, what we are trying to do here? So what we're trying to do in an adversarial attack is we want to find a small perturbation that misclassifies a sample. So here the delta would be the perturbation, we add it to our image X, and we just want our classification here indicated as the function of C to be different from the original image classification. And at the same time, we want the perturbation magnitude to be relatively small, and also we want to obey the image range from 0 to 1. And this here, the D is like just a distance metric. This can be different norms such as L.
Sorry about that. Forgot to press record in the beginning.
Don't worry. This is just a distance metric, which can be the L1, L2, L infinity norm. And this just is there to make the perturbation as small as possible. Then we can also divide into untargeted scenarios and targeted scenarios. This is simply in the untargeted scenario, I don't care to what my sample is misclassified as long as it's misclassified. In the targeted scenario, I really care. I want to induce a misclassification through my perturbation. So for example, if I originally have a dog, I'm only successful if this dog image is later classified as a cat. So, and then there are going more into the transferability direction. There are white box attacks and black box attacks, so to call. So in the white box attacks, the adversary has the full knowledge about the model. So type of network, how it was trained, access to the gradients, etc. And also the attacker can then utilize all of this information to craft his attack. And there are plenty of attacks developed in the community for these white box settings. And then we go further along this direction. Then we have the black box attacks. And for the black box attacks, we assume that we have no knowledge about the model and and how this model was trained, etc. And then there are multiple ways to attack such black box attacks. And we can either have maybe the ability to query such a model. So this is usually considered in, for example, if I have like an API online where I just would provide an image and I get the result. So I have access to the query there. And then some people constructed black box attacks, which are so-called query based. And then there's also those transferability based attacks where I, during crafting my perturbation or my adversarial example, I do not actually access the black box model. So speaking that I actually take my own substitute or surrogate model, as it's very often called, I craft my adversarial example on a surrogate model. And afterward, I just give it to my black box model. And we today, we will actually mainly focus on exactly this topic of this transferability. So that we, where we really, like we craft a sample on a surrogate model and then feed it to the black box model. And actually, Chowning will now continue with the transferability of adversarial perturbations. And do you share your screen here then?
Hello everyone. My name is Chowning, and I will take over from my colleague. And I will just like what? So as my colleague Philip has just introduced the definition of transferability in the context of adverse attack is shown on a slide. Is say now currently you have a white box model, and this is your own model, and then you can generate an adverse example based on your own model. And after that, you take the generated adverse example, and then you use it to attack the black model. And the black model in this scenario is the target model. It's the model that you want to attack. And again, the assumption here is that you can not access this model. You assume you have no knowledge about it at all. And the only thing you can do is use a surrogate model to generate an example and then to attack it. And then here we cover a little bit a background on the in the community that has already, because in the community, the adversarial topic has been explored for a long time. It dated back to the FDSM attack, which was proposed in 2013 by Jan Goodflow. And this attack was very straightforward and simple. You just put an image you fold into the model, and then you get the output, which we call logic vector. And then based on output, then you can compute a loss function. And then from the loss function, you can do the bad progression. You can do the bad progression to the input, and then you get a gradient on input, and then you can simply update the original image X with the calculated gradient, which is actually almost exactly the same as how we normally train a network, right? And the only difference between training a network and training an adversarial example is just the target is different. Actually, actually training an adversarial example is even more simple because you have much less parameters. And also here, it's only a single step. That's why it's called fast gradient assign method. And then this single step, it's very fast, but it's not efficient enough. It's not effective enough. So later, the community proposed a new attack called IFDSM. I here indicates iterative. So it's on a conceptual level, it's very simple. I can put the image into the model and I attack it once. If it does not get attacked, I attack it one more time. So it's kind of theoretically guaranteed IFDSM would be stronger than the original FDSM. What I just introduced so far was the two most famous white box attacks in this field. But these two did not really work very well when the when if you try to use it to attack the target model, the target black box model. And in this community, one very famous work to increase the adverse tunability is to apply the momentum into the IFTSM, and which is called MIFTSM. And this this simple technique can significantly increase the like the adverse tunability. And like on a high conceptual level, why does this improve the performance? It if you use momentum, you can make the perturbation more smooth, and which like kind of guarantees the like higher attack success rate. There's also one technique that's called a diverse input techniques, and then this idea is to when they apply the iterative method, the try when every time they try to use a different image instead of always using the same image. That's why it's called diverse. And this idea is very straightforward because the reason that if a for example can easily attack the white box model, but it cannot attack the black box target model well. And the main reason here can be simply attributed to the overfitting, right? So the basically the general the because the adverse example is generated on the white box model, so it's overfitting to the white box model, and it can attack the white box model very well. But due to the overfitting, it can only attack the white box model. When you try to attack the black model, the performance is quite poor. So then this idea is very straightforward. If the core issue is overfitting, then you just make the, every time you make the like the sample slightly more diverse to decrease overfitting. And there's also one more paper that tries to you to make it translation invariant. It's somewhat similar to the momentum. As you can see here, compared with like the FTSM or actually FTSM, the TFTSM will make the perturbation more visible, even though it has the same infinity constraint. I mean, like the reason is because it's only because of the human vision factor, because human vision is more more sensitive to the low frequency information. Let's say, for example, if the image only has random Gaussian noise, unless you see the image, you will not remember any information, right? But if the image has no more flower, if you see it, if then you close the eye, you can still remember the flower inside it. So this is only because of the human effect. And this is the how the community are trying to like exploit the gap between the human vision and the like the deep neural network. Because as Philip needed before, is like the human vision is very, very sensitive to the low frequency emission, while DNN is very sensitive to the high frequency emission. And okay, then next I will introduce two papers of our own, and both of them have already been accepted to a major conference workshop. And they are also currently still being reviewed to another to the in the new UAPS. Okay, so for this work, like one of our major contribution is to introduce a new metric to evaluate attack strength. What does it mean? Let's say before, like the community mainly use attack success rate or ASR to evaluate the attack success rate. ASR means the percentage of images being classified after attack. Very straightforward. And one of the major drawback of this existing metric is that it does not take into account like the instance wise attack strength. If it gets attacked. So it only, so basically, if the original image has a cat inside it, has like say has a type A dog, it, then I can attack it to let the network get full. Network will say, oh, it's no longer a type A dog. It becomes type B dog. But for the human, if you only full network from type A dog to type B dog, we will assume that this tag is quite weak. And only like in contrast, if you can let the network no longer to say is dog, you can say it's a mushroom or is it's like it's a human, it's a car, you assume this tag is stronger. And also if then also in terms of this kind of attack threat, you can, it also depends on which like the rank you use, because normally the network will output say, okay, the top one, for example, in the case is dog, then the top two is probably also dog, but it might be a different type. And then like, so basically like in, obviously if you now, if for this label, if you can let this label go to like go more down from the top one to the top two, top five, top 10. And obviously like the top five will be more like strong than the top two. And then for this paper, we propose this like new metric called ASR at K to evaluate this new attack strength. And, but for us to get the ASR at K, we need to evaluate for every K, and which is not easy to compare for different methods. So instead, then we propose a new metric that's called an interest class rank. So in this context, for example, the interest class can be the ground truth class. Like the if the image originally has cat, you assume the cat is the interest class. And then you like you care how like what's the new rank after the attack, and as simple as this. And then with this ICR, you can easily transform it to the ASR at K for every for like any K that you want. And another major contribution of this paper is that we proposed a new loss for boosting semantic adversarial attack to make the strengths stronger based on our geometric perspective on the loss design. And if any of you is interested in this like detail behind this loss, you can contact us later, but I think this might not be very interesting to the general to the general audience, so I will like skip this part. This part is also quite tricky. The result is that with different we first use our loss and we compare with the traditional different losses. We first compare in original white box attack scenarios, and here we have all different kind of existing metrics. We find that our new loss function contributes to a stronger attack for all these existing metrics. And then later we show this performance in two different scenarios for the non-target attack and target attack scenario. And we find that in both the scenario, our new loss function improved the performance by a significant margin. And truly like, if you read our paper, another main message of this paper, which I convey is that we try to claim that the stronger attack transfers better, very straightforward. And why would this message is even a word conveying in the first place? It's mainly because currently, if you read the existing papers in this field, they actually have most of the people in this field, they actually believe that weak attack actually transfers better. And in this paper, we find that this is actually not really true. For example, in our context, we propose a new loss function. We can get a much stronger white box attack. And meanwhile, we can get a much stronger black box attack. That's why it also improves the transferability. And as I mentioned before, for the DIFDSM that existing technique, I said, like, one of the main issue of low transferability is very straightforward. It's mainly because the general error example is all fitting to the white box model. And to alleviate this problem, we try to propose two very simple techniques, and it works like very well to alleviate this problem. And first, we do some two important things, like, one is the input noise augmentation, one is the feature noise augmentation. And it's very straightforward. It's again, if the overfitting is the problem, then you just add some noise on input as augmentation. Very simple, very straightforward. And somewhat surprisingly, even though this community like is so competitive, no one has done this very simple idea. And then we further extend this idea from the input space to the network feature space. And but the main concept is the same, right? Because in the feature augmentation scenario, say if general error example, you can only attack this single model, then it cannot transfer well. If I augment this network feature every time, then it means the general example can attack multiple white box models. If you can attack multiple white box models, you have much higher chance you can attack another random black box model. That's the very simple philosophy behind our design choices. And yeah, and we also for the target case, we also propose a new loss called push-pull loss. It's also very, very straightforward. Basically, it's if the original class is cat, you want the network code to fold it to say it's a dog. And the original, like most existing papers, they only try to maximize optimize the loss function to maximize the probability of the dog, of the network will classify this image as dog. But in our case, we try to explicitly decrease the probability of us, especially to increase the logit of the target class, but also try to explicitly decrease the probability of original ground truth class. That's why we call it push-pull. So escape one is to push it away from the original ground truth class, and also pull it close to the target class. And yeah, and then basically it's just two existing cost entropy loss function, not fancy at all. We just very naively combine them. Like surprisingly, this also improves the performance by a very large margin. Yeah, and basically in terms of the techniques, that's all about this work. And then later I will show that this improves the performance by a large margin. But this is like, you know, every paper say, oh, I propose a certain technique and I improve the performance by a certain margin. I want to share how I feel after I do like this work. actually we feel really, we don't really feel like very, very proud to say, oh, we come out very fancy technique or something. Like, as you can see, it's not fancy at all, but it's somehow in the community, we find that there is a tendency to like use very less fancy, complex techniques, and they come up with a very like fancy storyline to motivate their approach. And our work, I would say the major contribution is to say, hey guys, in this community, right, you don't really need these fancy techniques. These simple techniques are already sufficient enough. Yeah, and as simple as this, because if we really believe that if you can achieve the same purpose with very simple techniques, why bother to even attempt with a more complex solution? And yeah, as I said before, and we can see that our performance improved by a large margin. For example, for the we can see like the last here last column, like C is the existing loss function, and it can attack, for example, 94.8%, and it still has a quite large margin, right? Still, but we can improve it to 97.8%. Actually, when we use a very, very like strong baseline MIDI-TFDSM, if you actually use a relatively weak baseline, the performance improvement is more visible. For example, with MIDI-TFDSM, and the original performance is 82%, but we can increase to close to 95%. And yeah, and here we also compare with the different loss functions, and like there are several existing papers to propose like pole chip loss, FDL loss, and arguably I would say they are very complex, and our very simple PP loss, push pull loss, as you can see here, the performance like 2. It outperforms the DR method by a large margin. And this PP loss is also complement to our noise augmentation idea for both feature input augmentation and feature augmentation.
I'm sorry, it was so many different words here, the new ones. So if we can go back and recap a bit, so this would be easier to understand. I'm sorry that like I'm cutting this in the middle, but I'm trying to follow. Actually, first, if we can even go a bit further back to the ISR part. ICR, sorry, I would say, I think about seven slides ago. Yeah, this area.
Yeah.
Okay. I think I didn't understand something about the sphere here, then how we're calculating the error rate, if the loss here. If you can recap this, and then we'll continue to the PP loss, which is also on the same topic. Okay. Could you explain again?
Mm-hmm. Okay, I will first introduce like what does ICR like mean? Okay, it's like nothing more than say, because it's especially interest class rank. Assume now you have a sort of interest class, which in the anti-tech, for example, you have a cat image, and the cat is interest class, right? Mm-hmm. And the original rank before the attack is top one, right? It's highest, it's the top one attack. And after attack, these will no longer be a top one, might be top two, top three, or top four, top five,
and
right?
We wanna go top as much as we can because we want the distance between the cat and whatever we're attacking, yes.
Ideally, in this with this definition, what would be the strongest attack? If you now can let the network to for the cat to become the lowest rank, right? Mm. To say the last thing you can be is cat. You can be anything except for cat.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. This is like the definition of ICR. And in this paper, we propose a new loss called the RCE. It's like a relative cross entropy loss because
relative cross entropy loss. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Cross entropy loss is, as you know, is the most widely used existing loss function in this field. Mm-hmm. And we just add a relative regularization term. And like then if for this loss function, if you then try to derive derivative to the logit, you will find that it has a very good property. For example, if the original of the class is, for example, is here.
If this is now, the cat, it, yes.
Yeah, like now if I want to say, oh, become less cat, and the loss function that I designed, we are just try to make, let it go to the opposite direction of cat. Let's assume like now we have three class. This is the cat class. This is the dog class, and this is the horse class, for example. And the existing loss function, for example, like the C loss and CW loss, what tries to do? It tries to find a kind of shortcut to for the network. That's why if your step is here, what do you do? Which is the easiest way for you to like for the network, right? Or you know, if all whole region is A, right? You want to fold it, you want to network to say it's either B or either C. Obviously, at this point, it's easier for the network to go to B instead of going to C. That's why the existing loss function tried to utilize this kind of a prior knowledge. And our loss function, we just say, hey, do not try to choose the shortest path for the network. Just try to go the most far, go as far as possible. Do not try to go as fast as possible. Actually,
the accesses signify the different classes. So this is something I'm missing here, because if you're looking at the axes as different classes, there is no difference between the distance between A and B and the difference between A and C, because it's just the difference between the axes, and they're all tangential to one another, right? 19 degrees. So the distance is the same. Doesn't matter if you're if you're cat to horse or cat to dog or cat to different cat, if I understand this correctly from the image.
We have three classes.
Yeah.
Each one occupies angle of 122 degrees, right? And we assume the origin sample is at here. If you want to fold the network into a different class, since at the moment your class A, right? Now, if you want to fold the network, because this is like a toy example to illustrate the concept. And we only have three classes. Origin class is A. So if you want to fold in the work to become non-A, become a different, then it can be either B or C, right?
Yes.
And you can see here, obviously, B or C, which one is easier, is easier to go.
Obviously, smaller distances towards B, okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that's the existing loss function try to do. Is this Kalimagnon loss, cross-entropy loss? That's why they try to choose it, go in this like B direction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, go to the class region of B. But our loss, as you see here, is actually in this direction. And you can see because like class A is in this direction. The more you go into this class, into this direction, it becomes less and more A.
Uh-huh.
And then the opposite direction, like regardless of the position, right? You can see this angle, like this direction is exactly opposite of the direction of like this direction, right?
That's okay, but where is the rank coming into play in this example? Where do you input the rank as a way to regularize that you're going as farther as possible?
Actually, in this paper, I size only a metric. So then you will see, for example, then you will see here, this one is our RCE loss. So here, totally we have 1,000 classes, right? So which means like if you want to flow an image, if original is like top one, ours we can make it into top 1,000, which means is the strongest attack. But if you compare with existing class on the metric of ICR, then you will find that all the existing loss functions, we are like very, very far from the 1,000, but our technique, we can perfectly achieve.
I still not understand. If we have different ranks for the distance between a cat, where is that distance used in the loss function or in the gradient calculation?
No. Actually, this rank is not you. I understand your question. So your question is that how is this ICR used in the in this loss design, right?
Yes.
No, ICR is not used anywhere in this loss design. That's why we try to avoid it. If you try to use this kind of information, you might be overfitting to this metric. This is only one our proposed metric, but the whole message will pop up and say, oh, we propose a new loss function. We can achieve strong attack. But then how can we like really claim that our attack is stronger?
I understand. Okay, so another question: how do you define that what makes you say that if you go farthest from A, you're also going on the ICR scale the farthest? Like why is it connected? How does it, or maybe that's the way that you define the hot vectors or.
Yeah, let's say conceptually, if original the class A is highest, right? The original mm-hmm. class A is the top one.
Mm-hmm.
Now you want to A to be like to be the lowest. Then what should you do? You should not care about any other class, right? You should only say, for this sample, just go into the pure negative class A direction, because the pure negative direction would be the very, very last direction.
No, I didn't understand. So let's take again the example of cat. What makes us say that the opposite side will be horse and not a different type of cat?
Let me give you a simple explanation like this. For example, if you know, like this kind of classification is based on the logit, right? If the logit is high, if the cat logit is high among all the different among all the classes, we say the network will say it's a cat, right?
Okay.
Yeah. If the logit of the cat class is very low, for example, it's -1 million, for example, then. Yeah. Then this cat will be ranked as the final last, right?
Yes.
Yeah. Let's say now, imagine if you want the network to say, yeah, regardless its current content, you want the network to say it's more cat. What should you do? You should try to increase the logit class of cat as much as possible.
Yeah.
Yeah. Vice versa. Now, if you want, regardless of the current regardless,
I understood. So what you're saying here, we're trying to train, we're trying to create the attack to be farther away as possible from the ground truth model, from the ground truth class.
Yeah.
And then you're showing that this method is correlated with very high ICR score.
Yeah, I can. Which actually,
and you prove this in the result. Okay, now it's now in the same. Okay.
Actually, we get. This is the best result any method can achieve because the top 1,000 is the highest.
Yeah, yeah.
We only have 1,000 classes.
And understood. This
because with our method, we only resize it, but we also for existing other metrics, ours also consistently like the highest. We get best result because otherwise audience might say, hey, you create your own metric. Now you get best for your own metric, right?
It's not that you're trying to target a specific target class. It's that you're not just that, but you're also saying not just a specific target class, but also as farthest away from cat or whatever ground truth.
Makes sense.
Okay. Now, if another thing, and one slide back, I think the logit vector gradient derivative slide.
Okay. This one?
So what is the J here?
What J?
And J equal arc max, I not equal ground truth, Z X adversarial.
J equal arc max indicates the highest class, but it's like the class that, for example, say, for every example, you put in model and you finally get final have the large vector, which is the Z, right? And then for the whole vector, for his whole large vector, you check which logic is biased.
This is like the output of the adversary. This is like the chosen, basically the last class that is, this is chosen the class that is associated with the adversarial example, or is it used for something calculating process? Is this the output of the calculation process, or is it used during? That's the question.
Only output.
The output. Okay, that makes sense then, because we don't have it in the table.
Yeah, we didn't have it. It's very, whole thing is very straightforward.
Yeah, okay. Now this makes sense also. So I'm sorry that we jumped between topics, just like terms. Following, it's a bit tough. And now we were looking at the techniques for improving transferability, push-pull loss. So that's also on the same area of, we want to go farther away from the ground truth and also closer possible to the target. Yeah. Okay. Now there is the slide transfer-based attack and non-targeted setting. This one. This is not push-pull techniques here, right? This is without push-pull.
Yeah.
And this is just to say, okay, before push-pull, we have these ASR values.
Yeah, and as you see here, like this paper, we have proposed two different techniques. One is augmentation. And for the augmentation, we further divide into input augmentation and the feature augmentation, okay? Mm-hmm. And the other category is for the loss function. So the two are different. So basically then, so then in terms of the result, we first need to show the effectiveness of applying noisy augmentation, either on input or on feature level. And then—
understand, okay.
Then later we'll show the result, the effectiveness of the push-pull loss. And this slice—
No, 1 second. So the input augmentation and the feature augmentation both are not using push-pull, right?
They are complementary.
Complementary to what? To them, to between themselves or to the push-pull?
Yeah, they are complementary to each other.
To each other, okay.
Yeah.
And so how is push-pull connected to them?
Yes, let's say, for example, at this stage, we have no push-pull loss, right? For example, here we show this only the original CE loss, then we try to use our input augmentation approach, the performance is improved, we try the feature augmentation, the performance is improved.
Yes.
If we combine them, performance is further improved. Uh-huh. So yeah, but then at this stage, no PP loss is involved.
Yes.
And then the next slide, now we can see everything the same, based on very, very strong baseline MIDITI, and now we have different loss functions. We have C loss, pole trip loss, and FDA loss, and our PP loss. Okay.
Uh-huh.
And now we try to compare our PP loss with existing loss functions, and the value here is like the higher, the better. As you can see, pole trip, this only achieve around something like it's 80, but we can achieve 95. This is for the untargeted, and in the targeted with target metric, there's a 10, 2012, but we got like 28. So this is show our loss function is more powerful than existing loss functions. And then at this stage, then the computation is done. Okay, but now to show the PP loss is complementary to the input augmentation and the feature augmentation, we further combine PP with our input augmentation, the performance is further improved. And again, if we try to combine with the feature augmentation, performance is also improved. And we combine all of them together, we get the best performance.
Okay, yeah. Understood. Yeah.
Yeah, very simple.
Sorry for taking off for a bit, but now really clear. Thank you.
I think probably the other audience also have the same questions, and I thank your question for giving me this opportunity to make more clear to other audience.
Sure, that's what I'm here for. This is my job in all of these things.
Yeah, sure.
Ask annoying questions until everybody understands.
It's not annoying at all. I think it's very I think you asked the very right question.
Thank you.
You don't ask any teacher question at all. It's very, very relevant. And yeah. And
good time to ask anybody who's in attendance. If it's still something was not clear for you, please tell us now. You know, maybe we're running fast ahead, so take this moment. Questions for now. Okay.
Actually, my part is already over. If there are no more questions, I will then let my colleague Philip to take it over. But in case some audience have questions now, I can answer now, or you can also ask a question later after Philip, and then we can answer questions together. But just in case, if anyone has questions now, please ask.
I saw one question in the YouTube chat.
Good.
If the ICR is extended to the, if we extended the ICR to segmentation or object detection.
Not really, but I think that might be a very interesting direction to extend. Thank you for the question. So at this moment we only focus on the image detection task, because this is the most fundamental one. But I think to attack object detection or segmentation is just one application of our method, but we do not run any experiment to get the result or something. But if you are interested, please do it and then contact us and show me what you have got.
Okay. One second. Then I will continue. And the next topic, what we will discuss. Now, as the final part of the presentation, we will discuss the robustness robustness comparison of vision transformer. A robustness comparison of vision transformer and MLP mixer to CNNs. So, all the adversarial transferability that we until now actually talked about was all for convolutional neural networks, and recently there have also been some advances in new network architectures. So just very simply, I'm quite sure everybody here is very well aware of this stuff. CNNs. We talked about them a lot. We have convolutional layers, pooling layers, etc. But one important property is also that they are shift invariant. And then we have the fully connected layers. I'm sure everybody is also very familiar with that, but actually those fully connected layers are shift variant, so they cannot handle a translation. What it simply means for the CNN, if I have a cat in some corner or in the center or wherever, this usually doesn't matter due to the shift invariants. So, and as I said, recently there have been other architectures have been proposed, and one of them is the vision transformer. So transformers have actually been shown quite a lot of success in the NLP area, and then people tried a lot to apply them to the image space, with this paper of the vision transformers, a great success was achieved, where they actually could outperform the CNNs. So, and what does vision transformer on a very high level do is like they split the image into patches and feed them into linear embedding sequences. And these are then put into transformers. And conceptually, these small image patches are all processed in the same way as a token or like a word in the NLP applications. But overall, for what we will talk about in terms of adversarial attacks, the architectural design and all of these concepts are not that important. If you're really interested in details about how it works, refer to the paper. This is just a very, very high level overview. The main takeaway should be, there are other architectures than the CNN, and vision transformers also should have been shown to outperform the CNN. The same is true for another work which was followed nearly directly after that, which is the MLP mixer, a multi-layer perceptron mixer. And the mixer architecture also separates here. It has like some channel mixing operations and some cross location or patch mixing operations. And what is I think the most important and interesting thing about the MLP mixer is that this entire thing is constructed out of multi-layer perceptrons, meaning those fully connected layers. They also apply some tricks that we previously learned in the deep learning field. So inspired from the vision transformer, they actually also separate their image into patches and then feed them in some way into those multi-layer perceptrons, etc. And they also use some skip connections. And they also, if I remember right, deploy some dropout techniques for the training. But overall, the interesting thing is really that they consist fully out of multi-layer perceptrons. So, and now what we, from when we studied the adversarial machine learning, naturally asked ourselves was, how do these newer architectures now respond to adversarial examples? And this is exactly what we then set out to explore and wanted to analyze. And we wanted to make a basic comparison between CNNs and the VIT and the MLP mixer. So what did we compare? So in terms of models and data set, we compared VIT B16, VIT L16, and these are just referring to basic and large, and 16 refers to the number of patches into which the image is divided. Same for the mixer, and then the ResNet 18 and ResNet 50, and here these SWSL and SSL refer to the semi-supervised learning and semi-weekly supervised learning, and these are just trained with larger data sets. And we included them actually to, since the VIT and mixer models are actually trained on larger data sets themselves. They are usually trained on the full ImageNet data set and then fine-tuned on the smaller ImageNet data set with 1,000 classes. And as our test, we used these are basically ImageNet data, just in a slightly different form, but it's ImageNet compatible and it consists of 1,000 images, so it's much faster to just test. So since we are not really training anything, but just testing on the adversarial examples and their comparison, this is quite convenient to use this NeurIPS challenge data set, which was also used for adversarial attacks. So now, let's first look at the robustness against those white box attacks. So meaning we have full knowledge about the model and we can directly attack it. And we tested the projected gradient descent. Actually, in our previous talk, we talked about this. We did not in detail introduce it today, but overall, it's very similar to the IFGSM that Chowning already introduced. And what is to know, it's one of the strongest, if not the strongest adversarial attack. And also FGSM, we talked about this already, and the Kalinin-Wagner loss and deep fool loss. And for them, it's to say that these two adversarial attacks try to actually minimize the perturbation magnitude. So here, we are not reporting the attack success rate, but we are reporting the magnitude of the perturbation, because these attacks always achieve a success rate of 100%, and then we just average the perturbation magnitude. So This means a higher perturbation magnitude here would refer to that the model is more robust since the attack needs to put more perturbation there. While if the number is lower, this means this is relatively simple to attack. I don't need much perturbation, so to say, to attack this model. And for here, for these two, we actually report the attack success rate, where a higher attack success rate refers to a model that is less robust, and the lower attack success rate refers to a model that is more robust. So now, if we look at these results and try to make sense of this quite big table, we can see that the VIT and the mixer have a lower attack success rate compared with the CNN architecture. So here we can cut a clear line. So for example, for the PGD attack, the CNN architectures can actually easier be attacked, so they are less robust, and the VIT and the mixer are slightly more robust. Then this is also supported basically by the lower L2 norm for the CNW and the deep fool attacks when applied to the CNNs. So if we again draw this imaginary line, we can see that overall the CNNs are kind of easier to attack, indicated by the lower perturbation magnitude. One exception that we actually found is that the mixer models exhibit an increased vulnerability to very small perturbations, especially here. If we have a very low perturbation magnitude, that's what this number here indicates, basically the epsilon value, then here for the mixer suddenly we get sometimes a higher value than for the CNNs. So actually we did not really figure out yet what is the exact reason for that. So there is something going on with the MLPs probably that has an effect on that. But yeah, we are currently not really clear about that.
How would you, by the way, thanks for answering exactly the question I had in mind, but if you were to try to figure out why, how would you go about doing that type of research?
Yeah, how would we go about that? I would first actually try to observe the phenomenon a little bit better, like make a plot over the very low, magnitudes, yeah, and see if this actually is consistent, or if there is a peak, if it's consistent, whatever. Maybe I can get some insight first from there, and then to be honest, I would try to test more mixer models, all mixer models that I can somewhere find, and see if it also consistent about them. And as soon as I get the difference between anything, I will start to think, okay, what is the difference between models or model architectures that might cause that? So, and then we always have the options, might it be the training, might it be the model architecture? So I would try to go in all of these different directions and see, basically isolate always one parameter and see if my results basically change.
And if it's related to the architecture mixer in comparison to convolutional networks, how would you try to explain like what's in the architecture is making that difference happen?
Yeah, then we have to go. I mean, I would have to make a hypothesis about what I think is going on and then really try to break it down into smaller pieces. I mean, that's how we usually... since we actually don't really have a real hypothesis for now, what it is, I actually also have a very hard time to answer that question. Yeah.
For sure. It's a hard question.
Yeah.
I was asking it just to understand So there are two types of methodological research happening here. One is if it's in the data or the process of training. So this is something that you can statistically try to figure out. But if it's a difference in architecture, it means mathematically there's something different here. And sometimes we can't run, you know, statistical tests to understand what is the mathematical difference. And I think this is the harder one of the two. And even for me, I'm not sure how I would tackle it, how I would show mathematically that there is a difference and this is why it's happening. But that's why I asked this. Maybe
I would also like
a process here.
Since these deep neural networks are usually so complex, I would also try to go the trial and error route and just try also to change my architecture randomly, what I think. Or I think I would expect maybe it's the earlier layers. So I would try to change, try to check them and see, oh, how about we just swap in and see an N now and see if we still see the same, right? Mm-hmm. Or we try to swap some C and N in the later layers and see if it's still the same. Mm-hmm. Or maybe it has to do with this patching. So I try to find something where I change the patch size or the number of patches, etc. Mm-hmm. Yeah, if it would be in terms of architecture. I would try to tweak those variables somehow.
Interesting. Thank you.
And also, I mean, really reading all the papers and see if somebody else also observed it and see maybe they have some, maybe they had already some insight. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you.
And the same phenomenon actually is also observed for the query-based attacks, of which we actually today not talked a lot about. So as initially introduced, query-based attacks, we have the model available for queries. And we here only use one query-based attack because they are usually very time intensive. So here we use the boundary attack, which is basically a decision-based attack. And it starts from a large adversarial perturbation and then iteratively just tries to reduce the perturbation while still staying adversarial. So, and already from the description of this approach, we can imagine that this requires a lot of queries and it's very, really time intensive. So, and what is shown here is again, the L2 norm. Actually, this should be the, okay. Here is still the L2 norm shown of the of this boundary attack. And the takeaway is basically the same. The VIT and the mixer models are more robust, indicated by the relatively higher L2 norm of the adversarial perturbation. So, and now we go into the black box model, what we talked a lot about today, about those transfer-based models. And we then generated, here are the source models on which we generated the adversarial perturbation. And these are all the models that are targeted where we evaluated the perturbation or the adversarial example on. So here on the, on the vertical line, we should always see, nearly 100% percent, since it's the white box model. And then we can, from this big table, we can again distill some observations. So first one is that the adversarial examples from the same family or like a similar structure exhibited a higher transferability, suggesting that models from the same family actually learn similar features. So for example, we can see that if I craft something on the VITB16, it would actually transfer the best to this VITL16 model, right? Same for if I craft is on this one, it will perform very well on the VITB16 model. So also interesting, if I generate it on the larger model, I can actually transfer better to the smaller model. Similar for the mixer. Here, this what I just said is not true. Even if I generated it on a larger model, somehow the transferability on the smaller model is slightly lower. Then here we have the full ResNet family, where we can also see, we have here 80% or something 50, while the numbers on the VIT and mixer models are actually lower. So and this is what I just explained here is also mentioned here in the yellow bar. When a different model architecture is used as the source model, there is also a trend that CNNs are relatively more vulnerable and transfer poorly toward the foreign architecture. So overall, these numbers are also lower than these numbers. And now we actually wanted to kind of investigate a little bit if we can pinpoint this to something, why these VIT and mixer models are more robust. So we actually designed a very easy toy example to test to test that. So we just take a very simple binary classification task of one image for each class. So we have one horizontal and one vertical black stripe on a this gray background. And then what we're doing is then we train a simple fully connected network, a convolutional neural network, and a small vision transformer on these binary classification tasks. And then we get 100% accuracy because it's really that simple. And we actually check that the models are kind of similar in their size. And then we checked again. We took the CNW attack and another attack, which is called the DDN attack in this case, and looked at how big are the perturbation magnitudes. And we can see, indeed, for the CNN, as we saw before, they are more vulnerable or easier to attack than this fully connected and VIT. And here we actually took, we were not able to train a good mixer model. That's why we simply approximated this a little bit with the fully connected. So, and what we actually aim to do here, or what we basically in the end figured out through our experiments, is that this thing indicates that we can give an explanation from the perspective of the shift in variance. So now if we look at the adversarial perturbations generated from these models, then we have here the two samples. So this is the adversarial example in the first row, and this is the perturbation, the resulting perturbation. Yeah. So here we can see that for the CNN, the adversarial perturbations look like these stripes here all over the thing. And then if we look at the perturbation a little bit amplified, we can see this just in more strength. While for the fully connected layer, we are actually only adding kind of this black stripe here and really do nearly nothing with this white stripe. So white here means zero values. And same for the in the other direction. What is also very interesting is here for the VIT, we can actually see that here some, this pattern emerges. And these are these small boxes that we get there. And these VIT patterns are actually likely due to the division of the input images into these patches in the VIT architecture. And we have the repeated stripes in the CNN, and we only have a single stripe in the center. So, and then we actually concluded, or we made the point that there might be a link between the shift in variance and the robustness of these models. So due to the shift in variance, the convolutional neural network has perturbations all over the image in the direction of the opposite class stripe. And the other models have perturbations only in the middle part. So, so then what we can basically summarize from this small work, what we did is actually an empirical study on the adversarial robustness comparison of the VIT and the MLP mixer, and a comparison overall of the CNN to the VIT and MLP mixer on white box, black box, and the toy example on binary classification. I actually let the frequency analysis out for today, but you can check it in the paper as well. And we found that the VIT is more robust than the CNN, and mixer is generally located between the VIT and the CNN. And the lower robustness of the CNN can be partially attributed to its shift invariant property of the CNNs. So I think we went actually again quite long for today. So I'm happy to take some questions. Even though we made the slides less, still, sorry for the
length. That was good. That was we're actually good on the timing.
Okay.
And also very clear explanation there. I'm looking now on YouTube. I don't see any questions there. Me, I also don't have questions now.
Yeah, I mean, also when there might be questions coming later up, or for the people who are watching on YouTube this video later, please always feel free to just write us an email, contact us through whatever channels, and usually we will get back to you and try to answer all the questions that arise.
So I see here Amanda asked something on the YouTube chat. If it appears to be affected by shift invariance, have you looked at NF nets to see if the same pattern holds?
For the NF nets, we didn't check yet, because we did this work. Yeah, basically we started this nearly directly after the VIT and the mixer came out. Also for the NF nets, I think right now we are again in some era where suddenly a lot of new architectures are proposed, which is actually really great. So also there, I would say there is so much opportunity always to test, especially for the adversarial examples. But I also have to say, this is very quick, and probably already searching on Google Archive NF nets adversarial example, there might already be something out there. I didn't check yet, but same for the MLP and VIT. Papers come really, really quick, especially for these adversarial machine learning. We didn't specifically test, but I would nearly bet that there's already one paper out there discussing that. And also I would think probably NF nets will also be still vulnerable to adversarial examples.
Any more? See. I think not. So I think, guys, I will conclude for us. Chowning, Philip, thanks again for joining. And again, for an interesting talk. You guys are so productive. You push out so much work. It's very impressive to see.
Thank you.
And I will say thanks to everybody in the audience. I'm still looking for questions if there are, but I see none. Thanks, everybody, for joining in and tuning in and listening with us. And I will say have a good day. Have a good evening wherever you are in the world. And until the next time.
Yeah, thank you, always. Thank you, Peter.
Thanks.
See you guys.
Bye.
Bye.